Tonight, we're going to be beginning our discussion of the four step. And please remember that in accordance with group conscience, we have strengthened and lengthened the step series to so that we're able to look at these steps from the standpoint not only of ourselves as people in recovery working the steps, but also in connection with the directions that we have and the duty that we have to carry the message to others. So we're looking not only at the steps and how they work for us, but how we teach the steps as well. Well, one other thing, if you have an AA birthday, or if you prefer anniversary in December, and you haven't given us your name or like celebrate with us tonight, please see Janine, and we have access to all the medallions we need, so we'd be happy to have you celebrate with us. Okay. If you have your big books, please open them up to page 63. We're going to be looking at the last full paragraph on page 63 because it is in part a lead-in to the fourth step, and also contains some information we didn't get a chance to discuss last week. Last full paragraph on page 63. We found it very desirable to take this spiritual step, that is the third step, with an understanding person such as our wife, best friend, or spiritual advisor. Now, by the way, the word spiritual advisor, as it appears here, did not necessarily refer to a member of the fellowship, and I suppose in most cases did not, because many of the original members had spiritual advisors who were clergy or people who had some kind of spiritual connection with the member, but was not necessarily a member himself or herself. But it is better to meet God alone than with one who might misunderstand. The wording was, of course, quite optional so long as we expressed the idea, voicing it without reservation. That little phrase, without reservation, is of extreme importance. Now, of course, it's talking about the third step prayer, which we studied last week. This prayer is offered up holding nothing back. The phrase in the fifth step is withholding nothing, without reservations. In other words, when we say to God that we're offering ourselves to Him to build with us and to do with us as He wills, we mean that in the entirety of its full meaning. Our lives we are now dedicating to God and His will. It's kind of like this: here I am, God, take me. We're not holding back our sex life or our business life or our sports life or any part of our lives. Without reservation, we're making the offer to God. Then it goes on to say, this was only a beginning, though if honestly and humbly made, an effect, sometimes a very great one, was felt at once. Please note, this is only a beginning. And there are a lot of people who seem to make the mistake that the third step prayer is a prayer upon which, and the use of which, will keep them sober. And the big book seems to run directly contrary to that. My experience tells me that that's not necessarily true. In fact, I've never seen it to be true. Because this third step is, as it says here, just the beginning. This is where it all starts. Remember last week when we were looking at the third step prayer, we recognized that we were making an offer to God which needed to yet to be accepted. And that acceptance was going to come somewhere down the road when we'd done the work that we're supposed to do. Remember also that the third step is not just an entreaty to God, but is also commitment to God on our part to go forward with the rest of the steps. Going on now on page 63, this next paragraph is a lead-in to the fourth step and contains information which is quite profound and extremely necessary for us to understand. Next, we launched out on a course of vigorous action, the first step of which is a personal house cleaning, which many of us had never attempted. Though our decision, that's the decision of the third step, was a vital and crucial step, it could have little permanent effect unless at once, followed by a strenuous effort to face and to be rid of the things in ourselves which have been blocking us. Our liquor was but a symptom, so we had to get down to causes and conditions. You know, the big book is entirely consistent from one end to the other. Oh, there may be some little glitches back there in the stories. Some of the news stories seem to be a little bit odd to me, but then I'm a dinosaur, and I know that. But in the first 164 pages, in the doctor's opinion and the forewords, we find total consistency. When the big book tells us, it is telling us right here that liquor was but a symptom, it means precisely what it's saying. We don't cure an illness by curing the symptom. We cure the illness and the symptom goes away. Our problem, as we have already discovered, is that we are spiritually bankrupt, that we lack the power to recover on our own, and that this book was written for us so that it would enable us to find a power greater than ourselves which would solve our problem. So our liquor was but a symptom. In another place in the big book, it tells us that alcohol, the bottle was but a symbol. And so we're looking now at getting on with this, getting down to causes and conditions. And therefore, we started on a personal inventory. This was step four. A word about inventory, guys, because we're going to see inventory twice more in the steps, aren't we? In the 10th step, and again in the 11th step. If you were a shopkeeper, you wouldn't think of going into your storeroom and out in the shelves of in your showroom, try to take inventory of your goods in your head. You just wouldn't do it. I suppose there are some geniuses around who could do that, but that probably isn't any of us. And so we write it down. An inventory is a written list. And so when we're talking here now about taking inventory, we're talking about doing some writing. And a business which takes no regular inventory usually goes broke. Taking a commercial inventory is a fact-finding and fact-facing process. It is an effort to discover the truth about the stock and trade. Listen to that, the truth about stock and trade. When we take inventory in Alcoholics Anonymous, it is a search for the truth about ourselves. It is not a search for the truth about others in the sense of condemnation or blame. It is not an attempt to indict ourselves. We're not here to make ourselves wrong. We're doing this to find out what is wrong with us, the truth about what's going on with us, the things which have caused and contributed to our failures in life, the things which constitute in their total our insanity, our spiritual weakness, and our emotional immaturity. And so as we do the work of the four step, that's what we're doing. We're looking for these things which we must find in order to be freed from them. Going on, our object is to disclose damaged or unsaleable goods to get rid of them promptly and without regret. That's, of course, an allegory for what we're doing. Our defects of character, we wish to find the ones that need to go. We will get rid of them without regret. If the owner of the business is to be successful, he cannot fool himself about values. Again, we come right back to what Howie read tonight. Remember, the first paragraph of chapter 5 is real important to keep in mind, because it tells us that we can't recover if we're not willing or have the ability to be honest with ourselves. Self-delusion has been one of the hallmarks of our disease. And so, if we're to be successful in recovery, we cannot fool ourselves about what's going on with us. We did exactly the same thing with our lives. We took stock honestly. First, we searched out the flaws in our makeup which caused our failure. You see, the big book is not saying first we look to see what kind of a rotten, stinking person we were. It may be true that we were, but so what? That's not the point of the fourth step. The point of the fourth step is to find out what about us. What are what's the symptomology here? What are these things which block us from God? Now, it makes a lot of sense what we're doing here if we go back to basics again. Remember, in the first step, we came to understand and to accept the fact, as a fact, in our innermost selves, that we're alcoholics and all that that entails. Alcoholism being an incurable, invariably fatal, and progressive illness. We came to accept the fact that we had no power over alcohol. We're powerless. We can't stop drinking on our own. And all of the people around these rooms who say to us, just don't drink and go to meetings, are just whistling Dixie. Why would I say to you, don't drink, when I know that you can't not drink? That is, you've admitted your alcoholism. You've admitted that you're powerless over alcohol. And the big book says that our willpower fails utterly. And so we searched out the flaws in our makeup which caused our failure. Being convinced that self, this is very important now, because we just studied this in the third step, remember? Being convinced that self, manifested in various ways, was what had defeated us, we considered its common manifestations. So what we're going to be looking at now as we go through the fourth step and the fifth step is the manifestations of self. Selfishness, self-centeredness, self-centered fear, self-delusion, self-seeking, all of those aspects of self. And when you really look at it, if you consider self as being pretty much all-encompassing, pride seems to fall right in there. Pride being a manifestation of self. Overwhelming selfishness and self-centeredness, being completely immersed in self. The basics then teach us that we cannot recover without the help of a higher power because we're powerless. Therefore, the big book says that we're going to seek out this higher power. And we've just learned a little earlier in this chapter that God will relieve us of the obsession and the compulsion to drink alcohol if we seek Him. And so, searching out the flaws means that we're looking for our defects of character, our insanities, and our guilt and remorse and shame, as that is reflected in the harm that we have done others. Remember that we found out that we are the authors of our own misery, that our troubles are of our own making, that they arise out of ourselves, and an alcoholic is an extreme example of self-will run riot. Remember, we also found out that we had to be rid of self. We had to, or it would kill us. And that there's no way of getting rid of self on our own, that we had to have God's help. We're as powerless over self as we are over alcohol. it's a powerful message that we have already assimilated in the third step. And here we have the backup. We're extrapolating forward now, being convinced that self, manifested in various ways, was what had defeated us. We considered its common manifestations. We call these common manifestations defects of character. Going on, resentment is the number one offender. It destroys more alcoholics than anything else. From it stem all forms of spiritual disease. For we have been not only mentally and physically ill, we have been spiritually sick. And now here comes the capstone. When the spiritual malady is overcome, we straighten out mentally and physically. Please, take that sentence literally, because it is literally true. One of the things which is so important for us to understand, that there is nothing past God's power. I have seen miracles of physical and mental recovery which boggle the minds of the professionals. They cannot explain what has happened. But we're pretty sure what's happening here. We're looking at a miracle. Miracles are commonplace in Alcoholics Anonymous. Matter of fact, it's probably true. It certainly seems so to me that the second great miracle of our lives is when we were brought in the door, the first being when we were born. We're given something that, for each one of us in here, there are 10 people out there that don't have and never will have. Why us? God isn't talking about that. But he certainly tells us through the steps in the big book what he expects of us, which is that we become of maximum service to him and the people about us, to carry his message to other alcoholics. In dealing with resentments, we set them down on paper. We listed people, institutions, or principles with whom we were angry. We asked ourselves why we were angry. In most cases, it was found that our self-esteem, our pocketbooks, our ambitions, our personal relationships, including sex, were hurt or threatened. So we were sore, we were burned up. Now, before we get into the resentment list itself, let's look at the fourth step and see what it is we're looking at here. First of all, the fourth step is designed to uncover, to reveal to us through our inventory, the existence of what I call four cardinal defects. Now, you may call them anything you want or not call them anything, doesn't matter. But for purposes of identification now, the four cardinal defects are resentment, dishonesty, selfishness, and fear. We're going to find these same defects in the 10th step inventory, and again in the 11th step inventory, these precisely same defects. When we look at the 4th step, we will find that it is broken down into 4 parts. And each of those 4 parts is designed to show us one or more of these defects as they exist in us. Remember that we're looking at our present reality now. We're looking to see what it is today that is blocking us off from God. Therefore, when we look at the first section of the 4th step, we find that this is all about resentments. There is a corollary, of course, which is that fear is always involved with anger and resentment. And we are able to see that when we do our resentment list. But basically, the first part of the 4th step has us look at our resentments. But it goes beyond that. Not only do we find whom we resent and what they did to cause our resentments, how they harmed us, what the wrongs were, but we are also given the spiritual solution to resentments. So that when we follow the directions in the big book, we're able to be set free from our resentments. Bill said, when asked, how do I know if I did a proper 4th step? He said, if you had any resentments left when you finished, you didn't do it right. Because we have the complete spiritual answer, the remedy, the solution to our resentments. So we look at our resentments first, and then we apply the spiritual remedy, and we get rid of the resentments, and then we go to the second part of the fourth step, which is a look at ourselves. And in that second part, we're looking for our dishonesty, our selfishness, and our fears. And we do this by looking at our conduct as it relates to those whom we resented. It's a very neat package, because when we do this, we get specific examples of the existence of our selfishness and our dishonesty and our fears. At the same time that we're doing this, we're also making a list of the people we have harmed. Remember that our eight-step list is done in our fourth step. It will not necessarily be complete, but most of it will already be done before we ever get to the eighth step itself. The third part of the fourth step is a list of our fears. And we list our fears, and we list what caused our fears, what was the threat. And then we begin to use the spiritual remedy for fear. And what the big book tells us is that we ask God to remove these fears, and at once we commence to outgrow fear. So we write them down, we write down what caused them, and then we ask God to remove them, and at once we begin to outgrow them. And the fourth part of the fourth step is our sex inventory. And in our sex inventory, we concentrate directly on our dishonesty and our selfishness and our relationships, especially our sex relations. We also, by doing that, are able to identify the people we have harmed by our conduct in our relationships with others. As a result of doing this, we're able to discern, with God's help, what should be our ideal for how we are to live our lives in the future, our sex lives, our relationship lives. So those are the four parts of the fourth step. Now then, when we do a proper fourth step following the directions in the big book, leaving aside entirely all of the forms, whether they emanate from Hazleton, Joe and Charlie, or the local treatment center, if we just stick with the directions in the big book, we will have five results from a proper fourth step. First result is we will lose our resentments. Secondly, we will commence to lose our fears. Third, we'll have an ideal for our future sex life. Fourth, we're going to have a list of all the people we've harmed, and we will have become ready to make the amends necessary. And five, we'll have a list of our defects of character. I want to show you something, if you'll turn your books, please, to page 70, because many people do not realize that this is in here. And they're shocked to believe that the eighth step is actually done in the fourth step. If you go four lines up from the bottom of page 70, we have listed the people we have hurt by our conduct and are willing to straighten out the past if we can. Pretty clear, isn't it? By the way, when we get to the eighth step, there will still be some work left to do. We need to work out what amends are going to make and add anybody to the list who didn't show up in our fourth step. Now, all of these things are the result of working a fourth step properly, following the directions in the big book. And the people who do that, and there are many, many, many of them in here tonight, know that it works just exactly that way. We don't have to worry about it. We don't have to philosophize about it. We don't have to make up anything about it. We just have to do it. And when we do it, we get the results. So So now we're going to be taking a look at our resentments. Let's take an overview of resentments just for a second. Some resentments that we're carrying around inside of us have been there for years and years and years and years. We're not aware of them, except in those rare occasions of deja vu, when they come flooding back in. Generally speaking, we will forget them. Many of our resentments we have swallowed. The harm that has been done us in the past, we have denied, we have rationalized. We have deluded ourselves into believing it didn't happen, or if it did happen, it wasn't all that bad. Many of the people who have tried to help us in the past, if we've had a lot of experience with the human solution, have been trying to talk us out of having resentments, telling us things like they did the best they could. Well, that might be so, but I suspect in most cases it's not. But it's irrelevant, because you see, the remedy, the solution to our resentments doesn't have anything to do with us being rationalizing away our resentments. What they would like for us to do is to compare what we did to people to what they did to us and say, oh, they weren't so bad after all. And look how bad we were. Or, I wasn't so bad, look what was done to me to make me do all these things. Either way, we love it. But the steps in the big book don't indulge in comparative fault for very good reasons. We're not talking about spiritual solution there. We're talking about a spiritual solution to a spiritual problem. Some of our resentments go back so far into our past that we have very little memory of the events that took place. Some of our resentments are as fresh as this morning. All of our resentments have affected us in some material way, some of them severely. And so, because of the very nature of this beast, which hides out just like cancer cells and metastasizes through our psyche, it's absolutely essential that we take whatever steps necessary, do whatever we must do in order to ferret all this stuff out. If you're sponsoring people, you'll often find them saying, I don't have any resentments. You say, whoa, wait a second. You've already qualified for sainthood, I guess. Let's just see if maybe you do. Another thing you'll run into as a sponsor, maybe you've run into it with yourself. There are people who simply do not want to put the onus on other people. They don't want to make them wrong about anything. They don't want to believe that anything was done that was wrong and harmful. They want to believe that all of this goes back on themselves. And so when we ask them to determine whether what somebody did was harmful or wrong or threatening or made us angry, they're going to deny that any of that happened. The state of denial is not all that uncommon. So we have to find another way to get at that. And we do that by looking to see where they have been unfair. Well, now, if I want to uncover all of the defects of character, I mean, all of the resentments that I have, the first thing I've got to do is go back and review the important people in my life. Remember too that somebody who's new is having difficulty maybe with their memory, and a lot of the stuff that happened in the past we've blanked out so much that it really isn't right up in the front where we can remember it easily. So we have to have a way of jogging the memory, getting a process of association going, which will allow us then to go back with some specificity and to identify the things that were done to us so that we're going to be able to find out where these resentments came from. And so the way that we can do that, and this isn't in the book, by the way, but this is what I do, and I'll pass it along to you if you want to use it. I recommend that we sit down first and write out the names of everybody who was ever important or significant in our life, going back to our families, parents, brothers and sisters, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins, anybody who had any significant impact on our life from our family, our teachers, employers, friends, boyfriends, girlfriends, husbands or wives, children, jailers, cops, judges, psychiatrists, doctors, the list goes on and on. Whoever has had a significant impact in our lives, when we write these names down, there's a salutary effect in two respects. First of all, it's a non-threatening exercise. We're not doing anything about it yet, so it's a lot easier to kind of ease into doing a four-step when all we're doing is writing down names. Once we have those names down, we want to identify then who it is that we need to write about. That is, we need to find out who it is on this list who qualifies for the resentment list. And the way we do that works best that I've found. We simply answer some questions about each of the people on that list. We ask ourselves, did this person harm me in any way? Did this person wrong me in any way? Did this person threaten me in any way? Did this person anger me in any way? And then we have the one more question that kind of is designed to get around any reluctance we may have. Was this person unfair to me in any way? And I can remember a couple of instances in doing a four-step with a sponsee where the only question that she was willing to answer was the unfairness question. But it turns out that this her concept of unfairness cut across all of the aspects of harm and wrongs. Now, if we answer yes to any one of those questions, chances are this is the person whom we need to write about. Though our decision was a vital and crucial step, that's the decision of the third step, it could have little permanent effect unless at once, followed by a strenuous effort to face and to be rid of the things in ourselves which have been blocking us. Our liquor was but a symptom, so we had to get down to causes and conditions. Friend Jim here was asking me at the break about this business of don't drink and go to meetings, and most of you know my position on that. There's no such thing in the big book. And this is part of the reason. Our liquor was but a symptom. You do not cure a disease by getting rid of the symptom. The symptom goes away when you cure the disease. That's axiomatic, isn't it? Now then, let's see what it's saying to us here. We're going to need to follow through on our commitment in the third step, which was to immediately go forward with the rest of the steps. And this is telling us, do not delay. You must not, as a sponsor, fall prey to the siren song of delay and putzing around with your sponsees. And there are some now who are saying you don't even clear your mind up for 5 years and all this stuff, and one step a year and all kinds of absolute nonsense out there. Don't fall for any of that. Just follow what the big book tells you to do and you can never go wrong. Furthermore, you'll always be on solid ground with your sponsees because they'll know that you are following the directions in the big book which you have promised them you would do, and that they've got a solid reference for themselves. They don't have to wonder whether what you're saying is some kind of idea of your own or whether this is the method of recovery which is being used by people all over the world and was used by those who wrote the book. A strenuous effort to face and be rid of. Now, to face means just what Tom read at the beginning of the meeting. This business of being honest with ourselves. we have been running from these things. These things which have been blocking us. We've been running from our defects and our guilt. We've been running from the consequences of our drinking and of our actions. Many of us were taking one geographic after another. When we couldn't run, we drank more. The more we drank, our behavior became crapped out, and the more people we hurt, and the more we did to ourselves. So now we're going to have to stop all of that and face ourselves. If you want to change that word face to be honest with ourselves, you would be dead right. To face and to be rid of. Okay. We are not going to be rid of these things about ourselves by ourselves. We're going to find out, we've already found out that we can't get rid of self by on our own. We have to have God's help with that. We're going to find out that we cannot be rid of our resentments on our own. We have to have God's help with that. Likewise with our fears and our dishonesties. So across the board, to be rid of these things means that we're going to have to elicit God's help to do that. Of course, that's what the seventh step is there for, isn't it? In addition to that, we're carrying a load of guilt, and we need to be freed from that as well. And that will be done when we do our ninth step, make amends. It's a spiritual step. God's help always is triggered by that. And we will be set free from our guilt if we are thorough and honest and make a strenuous effort to set matters straight. By the way, we're going to find out as we do our four step just what those amends are that we need to make, because the four step covers that. We'll do most of our eight step list as we do our four step. And so now we see that we must move along here, and we do not delay. I would suggest to you that if you can possibly do it on the day after your sponsee takes the third step prayer, we get them started that the same day on writing their fourth step. Strike while the iron is hot. There will be, and usually there will be some sort of euphoria that is the result of the third step anyway, which means it's a real good time to move right along and get this stuff done. Now let's talk about the fourth step and what it is and what it is not. First of all, the fourth step is designed to discover four cardinal defects about ourselves. When we analyze the fourth step, we will find that the first part of the fourth step deals with resentments. There is, of course, in every instance, an overtone of fear, because we're going to find fear relates to all of our defects. So the first part of the fourth step is where we find our resentments. But the big book takes us far beyond that, because it gives us not only the opportunity to find out whom we resent and why, but also to be freed from these resentments. In other words, the fourth step teaches us and directs us to use a spiritual remedy for resentments. Bill said at one time, he was asked, how do I know if I did a proper fourth step? And he said, if you got any resentments left when you finish, you didn't do it right. Now the resentment list is the first part of the fourth step. The second part of the fourth step is the list of our own wrongs and our own defects, and it is designed for us to find specifically dishonesty, selfishness, and fear in our dealings with other people. And the way it is set up, we will write those, we'll write that second part of the four step with relationship to the people whom we resented. We already have that list, and we're simply going to go back to it and examine ourselves in the light of that list. This means then that we're going to be looking at what it is that's wrong with us. Now, this is the key to the four step. The four step is not designed, and you got to emphasize this with your sponsees, it's not designed as a condemnation or an indictment. It is designed to find out what's wrong with us. In other words, to find out what is blocking us from God. Just exactly what that little paragraph top of page 64 said, to be find and to be rid of the things in ourselves which are blocking us. That's why we're doing a four-step, is to find out what these things are. So the second part of the four-step will also begin our identification of those we've harmed. And we begin the process of becoming willing and ready to make amends to those people. The third part of the four-step deals with our fears. And in that third part of the four-step, we thoroughly identify all of the fears that we're carrying around with us that we came in the door with, or anything that has cropped up since then. But it goes beyond that, because in the fourth step, we not only learn what our fears are and what caused them, but we begin the process of using a spiritual remedy to be freed from those fears. We begin a process of writing our fears down, writing down what it is that caused them, and asking God to remove these fears. And the big book tells us that at once we will commence to outgrow fear. When we get to the fifth step, we will have been had these fears removed from us. The big book says our fears fall from us. So that gives us a little formula, which we'll talk about several times, I have no doubt. But it's simple. The fears recognized and written down and discussed with another and turned over to God equals no fear. And the fourth part of the fourth step deals with our sex inventory, and that inventory is specifically designed for us to uncover our selfishness and our dishonesties, and to identify the people whom we've harmed as a result of our sex conduct. It is also designed for us to, with God's help, craft an ideal for how we wish to live our future sex life. It has nothing to do with our future partners. It has to do with us. And it has to do with our willingness to be loving and kind and considerate and forgiving and honest and unselfish, and to demonstrate love, not simply to harbor love. It has to do with a lot of things, and God will direct us when we ask Him to. We need to write out this ideal. It's something we're going to be trying to follow the rest of our lives. So when you look at the four step that way, and you break it down, you find resentment, dishonesty, selfishness, and fear. These are the defects which the four step is designed to uncover. Notice it doesn't have anything at all to do with seven deadly sins. We don't deal with sin here in the fellowship. It doesn't matter what you read in other publications. We are not a religion. We don't deal with the concept of sin. By the way, the big book tells us that though when we find ourselves in a dilemma, that counsel with others may be advisable, but we always let God be the final judge. It tells us that we make no judgment about the sex lives of other people, and by implication about any of their conduct. It's not up to us to do that. We're not here as sponsors, we're not here as judges. We're here as teachers. Because if we can get our sponsees to let God in, God will take care of the rest. And so one of the things that we try to avoid is being overly critical. You got to remember that this term tough love is an oxymoron. You can be tough or you can be loving. It's pretty tough to be both, excuse the way I put that. Now, we know from the 10th and 11th steps that these four cardinal defects are the same ones which we will be seeking to uncover as we go through the rest of our lives. Look at page 84, please. Second full paragraph is the 10th step. In the middle of that paragraph, you will find that it tells us to continue to watch for resentment, dishonesty, selfishness, and fear. Those four. Turn to page 86 now, please. Top of the page, first full paragraph. This is the 11th step inventory. Notice that the first four questions have to do with exactly the same defects: resentment, dishonesty, selfishness, and fear. So it is no mistake that the four step is designed to teach us how to recognize these defects when they come up. We learn to do that by recognizing these defects in ourselves as we find ourselves when we do our four step, the stuff we carried in here with us. We must put aside the idea that we are looking specifically for any other defects. Now, what will happen is that your sponsee will find a lot of things about themselves that they find objectionable, that they want to change. And we don't have any problem with that. If they're lazy, or if they procrastinate, or if they have a quick temper, or they are jealous, any of those things. They will find them as they work through their four step. And all of that stuff can be included in the prayer of the seventh step as long as we recognize two things. First, that the cardinal defects are those that we must absolutely learn how to recognize and deal with. And secondly, that each and all of these defects and objectionable parts of our personality or our psyche are triggered by fear, that fear is the progenitor of all this stuff. You can look at it this way: pride is the godfather of all of our defects. And pride is just another manifestation of self. But fear is the hitman that pride sends out to destroy us. Now then, when we do a proper four-step, we're going to have five specific results from that four-step. The first result we're going to have is that we're going to be freed from our resentments. They will go away. This does not mean that we will not incur more resentments. It means that those we carried in with us are taken from us, because we use the spiritual remedy to be freed from them. We pray for the people whom we resent, and we ask God to make us willing to forgive the wrongs that they've done us. And we find out that we cannot hate somebody and pray for them at the same time. It doesn't work. Number two, we're going to commence to be freed from our fears. The Big Book says that once we commence to outgrow fear. Number three, we're going to have an ideal for our future sex life. Which ideal we're going to carry forward with us. It is the way, by extension, a way that we wish to deal with all of our relationships, sexual or not, as we go forward from here. Number four, we're going to have a list of all the people we've harmed, and we will have become willing to make amends. And turn to page 70, please. A lot of people don't realize this is in the four step. Go up four lines from the bottom of page 70. We have listed the people we have hurt by our conduct and are willing to straighten out the past if we can. That's pretty specific, isn't it? So So you see that the eight step is substantially completed by the time we do our four step. And the fifth thing that we will have as a result of this proper four step is we'll have a list of all of our defects of character. And that's the list that we're going to carry forward into our fifth step. Okay, are there any questions from anybody so far? Yes.
Jim, will you speak to the idea of that fourth column? Because it makes me nuts every time I have to speak with someone about that idea of comparative faults and comparative. And it makes me absolutely crazy.
Yeah. Well, me too. But the reason it makes me crazy is because it doesn't work. You see, let's take a look. Pardon?
Sorry, I was just asking, what is he talking about?
Oh, okay. There are some forms out there that you fill in, the blanks. And they have not only the three columns, which are listed on page 65, but also a fourth column, or sometimes there's more than one additional column where we write down our own faults and the things that we did. In other words, we put them all together in one package. There's a serious problem with that. It means that we are now comparing our fault to their fault or their fault to our fault. We're not allowing anything just to stand out as it is, and especially we're not allowing the things that others have done to us to simply be there without having been ameliorated in any way by the stuff that we did. Because here's the problem. Mama did X, Y, and Z to me, but look what I did to her, so she wasn't so bad. In other words, what I did to her justifies what she did to me. The idea here is that we're supposed to somehow or another stop being resentful because we recognize the nature of our wrongs, and this gives an excuse for the other people to have done what they did. And we run around saying things like, she did the best she could. It's very unlikely that that's true.
That takes away from the acceptance of it, doesn't it? You know what I mean?
Well, this isn't a problem of acceptance at all. It's a problem of forgiveness.
Okay.
Big difference.
Okay.
And we have a great deal of difficulty, most of us, in actually forgiving. So we ask God to make us willing to forgive. And when we do that, the forgiveness comes. But you see, what has to happen here is we have to be willing to use a spiritual solution for what is essentially a spiritual problem. That is all of this resentment. And when we try to compare our faults with their faults, it blurs all the edges. Now, for example, if you want to forgive something, to be effective, you need to know what you're forgiving, don't you? It has to stand out in stark relief so that there isn't any doubt in your mind what you're forgiving. Terry, do you have a question?
Yes. What's wrong with saying they did the best they
could? Well, because it's very unlikely that that's true.
How can you make that judgment?
Well,
that's what we even speak it in, the how it works, where it says, you know, people are incapable of being dishonest with themselves. Even they are not at fault, or they were constitutionally born that way, or whatever. I mean, we are saying even they did the best they can. Even saying it how it works. So how can you tell me that you can't say that about a parent or a spouse or a child?
Well, I'm not suggesting you can't say it. I'm suggesting that we need to be careful of that, because it may simply be an excuse for some really bad behavior that they very easily could have controlled. If, you know, I've heard so many horror stories already that I'm absolutely certain that the parents involved, for example, were not doing the best they could. Quite the contrary. They were being monsters. And for us to excuse their actions on the fact that they were doing the best they could means that then it's not necessary for us to forgive them. But in order for us to be free from the resentment, it's necessary for us to forgive. So we try not to take the edges off of any of this behavior. It's not to condemn them. It's for us. When we write out in our four-step resentment inventory the things that people have done that harmed us, and that threatened us, and that were wrong, and that made us angry, what we're doing is detailing those things which we need to forgive. Because it is in the praying for these people and forgiving the actions they took that we're set free. This is not for them. It doesn't have anything to do with them. It has to do with us. But a lot of times we're so afraid to condemn somebody, especially if we were close to them, that we will go lean over backwards in order not to, when in fact, that's irrelevant. What is relevant is if we're not able to clearly see what they did and then forgive what they did, it's ineffective.
Okay, I'm going to do that one more question and then I'll ask you later.
No, it's okay, Terry.
But I'm going to ask you this one. You know how we say in the rooms, I didn't know what I didn't know, meaning how I take that is, sometimes I take it as meaning, how can I be responsible if I didn't know any better, or I didn't know what I didn't know. Anyway, I'm going to throw out what I hear the most from my sponsees, and then you can just say what you will. What I hear the most is the alcoholic father who was abusive, and that's usually not the one the sponsee has a problem with. And my sponsees are women now, remember. It's the mother, the codependent mother, who didn't do anything because she was afraid. She thought she needed this husband of hers, or she thought this was love, or whatever. And didn't do anything to protect the daughter. So in the daughter's mind, what the mother did, although it was reprehensible, the mother did the best she could with what she knew, meaning, well, it's my husband, I gotta stay with him, that's what I was taught, no matter how he behaves, I need to. So you see, the mother did the best she could, in a sense. That's now you comment, I won't say anymore.
Well, of course, I've heard that many times, and the answer is maybe she was so disabled that she couldn't take any action but that. But in most cases, what I'm suggesting that's not true, that she reacted out of her own fears, her own selfish needs, wants, and desires. And she let her daughter be brutalized, and that's wrong.
But those three things you just named are the same defects we have. Fear, self-centered desires.
Of course.
Same as we have.
Of course. That's why we say that these people are sick too. That's why the big book says the people who harmed us are spiritually sick. That's why and then we pray for them. If you read page 116 in the big book, you'll find that the big book says that everybody has these same defects.
So we're on equal ground. In a sense, my sponsor,
from the standpoint of being insane, yeah. But you see, we cannot ourselves excuse our actions on the basis of insanity. Remember what the big book says, that we're the authors of our own misery, that our problems are our own making, that they arise out of ourselves.
Okay, then what does it mean when people say, I didn't know what I didn't know?
I have no idea, Terry. I really don't know what that means. In fact, I can't remember ever hearing that. But there's a lot of things that we say around here which state the obvious. And if I'm saying, I didn't know. Why do I have to say it twice? I just didn't know. I didn't know that what I was doing was wrong. Is that what that means?
Yes.
I have.
No, it means I had no more tools in the. I had no tools in the box. I had no choice because I didn't.
And that's never true.
I only saw. Not I didn't have a choice. I only saw part of the picture. It's too long to explain. I can't.
No. Listen. We understand. Think back now. Let's take you back into your own story. You are not sitting there telling us that all the crapped out action you took was without volition, that you didn't know what you were doing. You made decisions based on self constantly, as we all did. We did things that we knew were wrong when we did them. They went against our morals, they went against our sense of ethics and right and wrong. We knew right from wrong.
Okay, I can dispute you there, but I don't want to take up more time, but this is what I want to say as far as disputing that. If you were brought up to believe a lie by a parent, and you believed the lie, then you're going to act on that faith in the lie until you wake up one day and realize, my mother lied to me.
Sure.
Love is not putting up with anything from another human being. That's not love. That's sick codependency. agency. But as long as I'm believing that's love and I act on that, I'm going to do sick behavior. You see what I'm saying? I didn't know what I didn't. Do you understand?
Yeah, I understand that. Okay. That's what the four step is designed to show us, what actions of ours didn't work.
Because based on lies, based on what we thought was the truth, because that's what we were taught was the truth, we didn't know anymore. When you're a child and your mom says, day is night and night is day, you go, okay, I guess so, you're my mom.
Yeah, you're dead right about all this, but let me explain that we're not talking about making judgments here. We're talking about writing down what they did.
This started with you making the judgment when you said
No.
Let me say what you said. You said you said when you say to somebody did the best they could, you said that's not usually true.
No, my comment was it may not be true.
Okay, that to me was a judgment. I could be wrong.
No, it's just experience. You see, if we are acting under some kind of misinformation, our actions are nevertheless wrong in that they don't work. So the first thing we're doing here with a fourth step and a fifth step is to find out what didn't work. And then we start doing what will work. And when we start doing what will work, that's when our whole life changes. And so there's no condemnation intended in the fourth step at all. This is very practical. We're looking to see what it is happened. What happened to us and what did we do to others? And from that, we learn the lessons we must learn, which are what did not work. And what did not work is what we stopped doing. Now, in order to be freed from our resentments, it's essential that we forgive the wrongs that were done us. And we need to know what those wrongs were. And when we go around excusing the wrongs, what we've done is take the edge off of our forgiveness. So the big book does not dabble around in some kind of thing where we're trying to be talked out of our resentments. You can't talk us out of our resentments. We make these things stand out in widescreen, Technicolor, stereophonic, and Dolby, so that when we forgive them, we know exactly what we're forgiving. And anything that blurs those edges, what I'm trying to point out, we want to stay away from. Does that make clear?
That's fair.
Okay.
That's fair.
All right, guys.
On the lines of what we started out, the thing I wanted to point out, my experience, is that when I have indulged in looking at what they did and then saying, well, this is what I did and those sort of specific things, it winds up being a wash.
Yeah.
In so much as nobody ever gets to take responsibility for their actions, because it's very easy if I'm able to say Daddy did X, Y, and Z, but look at what a problem I was, then I'm not affording anything to anyone. Nobody has responsibility for anything.
And yeah.
What I've come to believe is that if I'm not going to take responsibility for what I did, for my actions, I'm never going to get any sort of sense of the sense of being forgiven mm-hmm. for what I've done, because in essence, I haven't really done it. I haven't done it because Daddy did this, and then I did that, and a wash and nothing really happens.
Well, yeah, the modern version of that is I'm only human. And nobody's denying our humanness. What we're trying to do here is to find out what blocks us from God. Whatever blocks us from God keeps us from recovering. The things that block us from God are the things that the big book enumerates for us. And those are the things that we find. And this is the way we go about being freed from those things that block us from God. So one of the things that we must do is to recognize that we are responsible for our actions. Now, there are those rare few who are certifiably insane and act under irresistible impulse. Maybe 1/100 to 1% of the population, some minuscule number. For the rest of us, what the big book tells us is correct. It tells us that we are the authors of our own misery, that God didn't do it, and that our troubles are of our own making. And it tells us that we step on the toes of our fellows and they retaliated, sometimes without provocation. But we invariably find that sometime in the past, we have made decisions based upon self, which have caused the difficulty. Now, I'm convinced that these statements in the Big Book are true. And I'm convinced then that we have to be very careful not to give ourselves any excuses at all for our crapped out behavior. Now, we're going to make mistakes and we're going to do wrong things. This is where the humanness comes in. But it is no excuse that I'm just human. It's just a fact. Now, that does not mean that I must not make every effort to correct. That's why I make amends if I've harmed somebody. That's why the Big Book tells us that it isn't likely we're going to be inspired at all times. We make a lot of mistakes. It's why we have the out clause, which we find in the fourth step as well. That so long as we do what we believe God would have us do and humbly rely on Him, that He will enable us to have serenity instead of calamity. Which means simply that we're not always going to know God's will. But when we do as we believe He would have us, and second and more important, rely on Him for the results, that we're going to be okay anyway. So we have to do a lot of stumble fumbling around as we go through recovery. We make a lot of mistakes. But the biggest mistake of all would be to give ourselves these excuses. It's just the opposite. We need to take inventory. We need to find out what went wrong. And the Big Book tells us that after we've done so, we are to ask God for forgiveness and to ask Him to show us how to do better tomorrow. So we don't excuse ourselves. We recognize our difficulties and then we use spiritual solutions to be freed from those difficulties. It's a whole different way of looking at things. And it certainly is not in line with human solutions. Just the opposite. Yes, Tom.
I still like to blame my parents for some of the shit they did. I was the first born, and you know, they didn't have a higher power. They didn't have any conception of, the only conception they had was how their parents raised. And I have my conception today of raising a kid is a lot better than what my parents did. But they're raising my little cousin up. Well, she's 18 now, 17. They're raising her totally different than they raised me. Because they've grown through and they've learned how to raise kids better. Mm-hmm. They had five of them after me. And a lot of their behavior was wrong. And I think that's where they did the best they could while they were still learning how. You know, and they made a lot of mistakes.
Well, all of that's true too. The only thing that's necessary to do is to not use these excuses. Because if you do that, then what's the point of forgiveness? There's nothing to forgive, is there? And yet, the actions were nevertheless taken, weren't they? And they nevertheless caused you the pain and suffering of resentment. You want to be free of the resentments? It's necessary to forgive the actions that were taken. Yes?
More or less, it's like saying, it's okay, you can be angry about that.
Well, why would you ever tell somebody that? Anger is a poison. You tell them it's okay, you can take poison. Let me show you. Look on page 66.
66?
66.
66.
Second paragraph, read out loud. If we were to live...
You have to be free of anger. The grouch and brainstorm are not for us. They may be the dubious luxury. Normal men, the alcoholics, these things are poison. Right, free, but I'm saying this is the process, like then the fourth step. Aren't you suggesting it's all right to feel anger towards wrongs, and then you can be freed of it? Is that what you're saying?
Well, I don't know. If it was all right, we wouldn't worry about getting rid of these this anger, would we?
Yeah, but what he's saying is, you said you try to take the edge off of what people did. You know, be frank, be honest, say exactly what they did. And if we do that,
right,
you feel angry.
You feel that anger first before you go on.
Oh, absolutely. Well, that's the reason that we're doing this, because we feel the anger.
That's what I'm saying.
Oh, no doubt about
it. It's all right to, because you're saying don't excuse your parents. Well, if I don't excuse them, I'm pissed off.
Exactly.
Right? If you're saying, oh, it's not true necessarily that they did the best they could, don't excuse it. Oh, well, then they did wrong things then, you're saying, right?
I'm saying, wait a second now. You're using the word I didn't use. I didn't say they did wrong things. I said they did things which harmed you.
Right.
Which threatened you.
That's a wrong. A wrong.
By one of the, sure, the wrong had all kinds of synonyms. You can call it a wrong if you want. The big book does, doesn't
harm.
It? Calls it wrongs. Look at the top of page 66. You will see the word wrong used three times.
Maybe we better go ahead and I'll tell you why. I forgot. I got to get up early when I go to work in the morning.
Monday morning?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I get up this job. I have to be there at 8. So
we really need to go on a Friday. Nobody else can lead that one. We can go 2 weeks if you like.
Now next week I don't have my children.
On your off week. Next week you have the children, right? Next weekend? Next weekend.
Yeah.
So the following weekend you won't. But we can go on the Friday night. Anytime, so just make it easy on yourself, okay? But I'm waiting for you to go with me. I know you will enjoy it.
What about, you know what I was thinking? I was going to say New Year's Day, but you have to do your meeting in Miami.
What? That's okay, and I'll make the rest.
The only reason it wouldn't be is if my parents are going to be here to help them.
Here, we'll see.
Thanks.
God, you're a hard girl to get a date.
Tea dry.
all right? That makes sense. You sure?
I think we made it to adulthood. Now it's our responsibility to be happy, joyous, and free if we want to be that way. Or we can just blame everybody in our past for all the problems I have today.
Well, it's our heritage to be happy, joyous, and free, but we got to work for it.
Yeah, and we have to go through all the shit and all the bad ideas.
But it is our responsibility to fit ourselves to be a maximum service for God and the people about us. That's our responsibility. And all of these things that we're doing here ultimately mean that we're fitting ourselves for maximum service to God by getting rid of the things in ourselves which block us. Now, the fourth step and the fifth step in the big book work for everybody who will do them. Just follow the directions as they are. They work. And there are the rationale for why the variations do not work are things that sometimes sound a little esoteric, but nevertheless, they're still true. But the methodology that's set out in the big book is what works. And there are specific reasons for that being so. And when we begin to look at ourselves, we do not want to color our actions with reference to what they did to us. And the big book's very specific about that too, isn't it? Referring to our list again, putting aside the wrongs that others have done us, we resolutely looked at our own wrongs, you see. And the reason for that is, in order for us to know what it is that is wrong with us so that we can take that to God, we have to be able to look at that undiluted by the actions of others. That's why these two lists stand separately, completely separated, except that they deal with the same people on both lists. Okay? All righty. And anybody going to pick up a chip today? I know sometimes we're kind of threatening to some Christians, you know. But I did the 12 steps for Christians. I wrote it, and it's being used now all over the place. It's the real 12 steps, not some hokey version of them.
Right.
But backed up by scripture. And it's being used all over now. And it's working.
Well, you know, there are a lot of things that work.
Glad you're here.